Hello students, I welcome you all in the third lecture on bio-inorganic chemistry. Previously, we had two lectures on this topic and we discussed different aspects of bio-inorganic chemistry in those lectures. Now we will continue our discussion from the previous lecture. So here you can see the biological functions of the metal ions. We have seen that so many metal ions and especially the transition metals, they play a very important role in different biological functions. So all the biological functions which are performed by such metallo biomolecules, they can be classified into three categories. First is transport and storage protein. So most of the metallo biomolecules, they play a part in the transport and storage protein, and in these type of protein, generally transition metal ions are involved. As we know that transition metals, they have this special property of changing their oxidation states and changing their coordination number, having variable geometries. So they can be used as a transport and storage protein, and during their function, they flexibly changes their different modes. Then metallo biomolecules can also be used as enzymes, and we have seen that so many metal ions, they are part of the coenzyme or cofactor, which plays an important role in the functioning of different type of enzyme. Like we have seen vitamin B12 that is having a cobalt ion in it. So many enzymes are also involving these metal ions, and most important ones are the oxidoreductases, which are performing the functions like oxygenation, hydrogenation, and also so many other functions like nitrogenase and enzyme, which involves such metal ions in them. Then apart from these two, when you have metal ion and the protein molecule involved, we can also have the non-proteins metallo biomolecules in which the proteins are not involved, but yes, metal ion is there. So such type of non-protein metallo biomolecule, they are seen in the case of metal transport and structural features of the cell membrane. An example is the siderophores containing iron atom, and skeletal structures of so many organism, it consists of calcium and calcium carbonate. Then ionophores, which mostly consist of the iron. So these are the three categories: transport and storage protein, enzyme, and non-protein. Now, if you talk about the transport and storage protein, these type of biological molecules, they can be the electron carrier. For example, cytochromes, iron sulfur type of cytochromes, and blue copper. So they have iron and copper atom in them, copper ions in them. Then we can have metal storage carrier and structural components. So for this, we have ferritin, transferrin, metallothionine, and sodium potassium ATPase. These carriers, they actually contain metal ions like iron, zinc, and sodium and potassium. Then some specific type of metallo biomolecules are involved in the oxygen transport. So they are able to bind the oxygen molecule reversibly. That is, when the partial pressure of oxygen is high, they bind the oxygen molecule, then they perform the function of transport, and then at the site of their release, when the partial pressure of oxygen decreases, they release this bind oxygen. So important examples are like myoglobin contains iron and involved in the oxygen transport in muscles. Then hemoglobin, we have seen in the human body, hemoglobin is involved in the oxygen transport throughout the body. Then hemoerythrin, it is found in certain non-vertebrates. And hemocyanin, also found in certain non-vertebrates, and they are also involved in the oxygen transport. If we talk about the enzymes, the metallo biomolecules, which serves as enzyme, we can have hydrolases, oxidoreductases, and isomerases and synthetases. So examples of the hydrolases are like carboxypeptidases and carbonic anhydrase. Both of them contain zinc ions. Then oxidoreductases, and most of them contains iron, zinc, and copper metals. In the case of nitrogenase enzyme, molybdenum ion is present. Then isomerases and synthetases, so they are like vitamin B12, which contains cobalt atoms, which function as a coenzyme. So these are so many important biological functions in which the metallobiomolecules are involved. So if you talk about the individual metals, so we can have the metals in the biological system which are functioning as the charge carriers. So here the metal ion involved are like sodium and potassium monopositive ions, and they can extend their coordination number and geometry up to the 6 and octahedral, and 6 to 8 in the flexible mode. Their preferred ligands are the oxygen containing functional groups like ether, hydroxyl, carboxylate, and their basic function is charge carrier, and they may play a very important role in maintaining the osmotic pressure and also in the nerve impulse conduction. Sodium potassium pump is a very well known pathway for the nerve impulse conduction. So these are the charge carriers. Then we also have the metals in the biological system which are playing a role in the structural features, and also they are functioning like a trigger. So example is like magnesium, calcium, zinc dipositive in the two different coordination numbers. We can have a 4 coordination number in the tetrahedral geometry, and also we can have a 5 coordination number in the square pyramid shape. Then we can have manganese dipositive and manganese tripositive, both of having the same coordination number 6, but different octahedral and tetragonal geometry. So they all prefer the ligand which contain the oxygen and nitrogen heteroatoms, and basically their function is being the structural part of the cell, and also they are behaving like triggers. So the example is like the magnesium, which is playing a role in the hydrolysis, isomerases, phosphate transfer, and trigger reaction. We have calcium dipositive as the charge carrier, phosphate transfer, and trigger reaction. Then zinc dipositive, which is used in the zinc fingers, gene regulation, anhydrases, dehydrogenases. These are the different enzymes which contain the zinc in the 4 coordination number. And also we have the zinc in the 5 coordination number present in the hydrolysis and peptidases. Then manganese in the dipositive state and 6 coordination number is the structural part of some oxidases and photosynthesis. And then the manganese tripositive again in the 6 coordination number plays a role in oxidases and again photosynthesis. Then we have metals in the biological system which are specially involved in the electron transfer reaction. So for these type of electron transfer reactions, the most preferred metal is iron. And it is found in the vertebrates and generally involved in the electron transfer reactions. And in the non-vertebrates, we have copper molecule. So the iron, it can be found in the both +2 and +3 oxidation state and 4 and 6 coordination number. So their preferred ligand are oxygen and sulfur containing heteroatom in the protein molecule. And they are involved in the electron transfer reactions in the oxidases, nitrogenases. Then if you talk about the copper, so copper can, the most preferred oxidation state of copper is +1 and +2. And it can have a coordination number of 3 and 4. The preferred ligand is containing the heteroatom like nitrogen and sulfur. And it is involved in the electron transfer in the type 3 heme copper oxidases, in the cytochrome C oxidase, and especially the blue copper protein and type 3 heme copper oxidation in the cytochrome C oxidase. Now, if we specially talk about the oxygen transport in the organisms, that is dioxygen transport. So oxygen is always transported in the O2 form. So in that case, we have again the copper and iron ions involved. And the copper is involved in the copper oxidases and hemocyanin, and iron is involved in the form of hemoglobin. So here some important functions of the metal ions are also listed here, and you can see that the hydrogen, it is being extremely important in the biology. It is used in most of the biological redox reaction along with many non-metals such as carbon and nitrogen. So basically it is involved in the structural building blocks of living beings. Now it is also used in the protein gradient across the biological membranes, which are universally used for the ATP synthesis. Then we have lithium ions, and although it is not required for the life, but it is used therapeutically in the form of lithium carbonate for treatment of maniac depression. And its mechanism of action is still undercover, and some research has to be done here. Effective treatment requires attaining cerium lithium concentration between 0.8 and 1.2 millimoles per liter. So that is a very small amount that is required for the treatment, and the only usage are known for the therapeutic purpose. Otherwise, it is non-essential element in the human body. Then boron is an essential trace element for plants, and it has been known that it is essential for the mammals as well. The boron containing polyether macrolide antibiotic, that is a boromycin, it was isolated as a potent anti-HIV agent. Then carbon, nitrogen and oxygen, they all are the essential element, and they are the building blocks of the living body. The carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen and oxygen, they all together constitute different macromolecules which are involved in the structural features of living beings. Now, some compounds of these elements, they have special role in the biological system. Like some of the biological effects of the important intracellular messenger, like nitric oxide, NO, which is derived from the amino acid arginine. It has been shown in the coming slide. This is the arginine, a soluble guanyl cyclase enzyme, and it is involved in the transport of NO plus. So it is activated upon the NO binding, and NO binding to the ferrous heme iron in the myoglobin and hemoglobin, you know, it is very strong, with a binding constant of 2 into 10 raised to power 7. So this is actually bound to the hemoglobin irreversibly, and then it becomes incapable of oxygen transport. So it forms a very stable complex. And then it is also involved in the generation of the Parkinson's disease, programmed cell death, antimicrobial agent, neurotransmission, impotency, and cardiovascular diseases are also known to be generated by this. So, yes, these type of molecules, they are basically behaving like intracellular messenger, and they are, that is how they interrupt the normal functioning of cell. Now, fluorine, it is in the form of fluoride that is added to the drinking water, and it is known to retard the dental caries, is criticized on the ground of its potential toxicity, although it is used in the anti-tumor drugs as a 5-fluorodeoxythymidylate. So this is the anti-tumor drug which contains fluoro as a part of it, and here the fluorine is involved in the therapeutic usage. So it is a so-called suicide substrate that inhibits the key enzyme of DNA synthesis, and it is named as the thymidylate synthetase. So that is how it prevents the progression of tumor inside the cell. That is the uncontrolled cell growth, it controls like this by inhibiting the DNA synthesis enzyme. When it is present in the limited quantity, very trace quantity, if it is present in the water, then it is known to strengthen the bones, known to strengthen the teeth. But when the concentration of the fluoride in certain areas, when it reaches beyond a certain level, then it is known to cause a very well-known disease, fluorosis, which is actually the deterioration of bone and teeth in the human body. So it is all about the dosage. At the very minimum dose, it is a trace element, required element. But at a higher dose, what happens, it is known to cause certain diseases, and even the very high dose can prove to be lethal. And in the moderate doses as well, it can be used as an anti-tumor drug. So this is the structure of this compound, fluorodeoxythymidylate, which is having a anti-tumor drug property. Now, sodium, which is very important in the biological functions, it is involved in the ionic gradients and it is used in the osmotic regulation. And despite its much higher extracellular concentration, it has to be kept out of many cells by the action of an energy consuming NAK ATPase pump. So generally, the sodium ion, it is sent out of the cell against the concentration gradient. And for that function to perform, we have an ATPase pump in the cell membrane. So it selectively take up the Na plus ion from the cell fluid and send them out. So that pump is an energy intensive pump, and it takes up the energy in the form of ATP hydrolysis. And this figure explains that how the ATPase function, the selective binding site for sodium, potassium, calcium and chloride in the transport protein. So such type of transport is performed by some special protein molecules embedded in the cell membrane, and we call them transport protein. So here you can see the sodium, it is selectively bound and sent outside, and the binding sites in the transport protein are shown for sodium, potassium, calcium and chlorine. So two sodium binding site in the LUTNA dependent pump. Then we have four potassium binding site in the KCSA K channel. Then we have two calcium binding site in the calcium ATPase pump and two central chloride binding site in the mutant chloroCCLH plus exchanger. So then coming next to the magnesium, it is also having a role intimately intervened with the phosphate and in many phosphoryl transfer reactions, and also as magnesium ATP in the muscle contraction. So it also helps in the stabilization of the nucleic acid structures as well as in the catalytic activity of the ribozymes. So ribozymes are basically the catalytic RNA molecules which are involved in certain enzymatic activity. It also serves as a structural component of enzyme, and it is found as the metal center in the chlorophyll. So this is the structure of chlorophyll A, which contains a magnesium ion at the center of porphyrin ring. And that is how it is very important for the living beings, and also playing a role in the phosphoryl transfer reaction. Then let us talk about aluminium. So while extremely abundant in the earth crust, aluminium is very little known in the biological system. It is a notorious neurotoxin, a very well neurotoxin, and it is known to generate Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease in the human body. So aluminium, although that we have seen in the lecture 2 of on bioinorganic chemistry, that if a metal is abundant in the nature, then it becomes abundant in the biological system as well. But this is not the case of aluminium, and it is known to be a toxic metal, a neurotoxin for the body. Now, what happens when the acid rain is there in the environment? It can change the usual association of aluminium in the soil with silicate. So when the pH is greater than 6.5, then what happens? The aluminium is actually combining with the phosphate, rendering the aluminium more toxic. So after the acid rain, the plants, they take up more aluminium from the soil. So this may be the reason why silicon is essential, because it keeps the aluminium in non-toxic form, that is aluminium silicate. But whenever the pH will be lower down, then it will be combining with the phosphate, and then it will become a potential salt that is taken up by the plant roots. So the importance of phosphorus and sulfur is obvious. The latter often associated with the iron in important family of protein that contains iron sulfur clusters. These iron sulfur clusters, they are actually known for their electron transfer reactions. Now we have silicon, and it is among the trace elements and part of the glutathione peroxidase enzyme, which catalyzes the removal of hydrogen peroxide from the biological system. So this is also required for the biological system, but yes, in very trace quantity. So this is the reaction of this glutathione peroxidase enzyme, which actually selectively oxidizes the peroxide H2O2 from the biological system. And that is how it reduces the toxicity of the peroxide ion. Now let us see about the chromium and nickel. So these metal ions, they are required in very small quantities, and they have uncertain biological roles. So chromium being used in the glucose metabolism, it is potentiate insulin and serve as a component of glucose tolerance factor. And if we talk about the nickel, so it have a role only in the plantain bacteria. For example, in the methane producing bacteria, it plays a role in the methane production and also in the SOD enzyme. Moving next towards the manganese and molybdenum, so they play a critical role in the photosynthetic reaction centers and again SOD enzymes. They support the brain function and reproduction. It is also required for the blood sugar formation and part of the bone structure. Now, central role in the nitrogenase enzyme catalyzing the nitrogen to ammonia and nitrate to ammonia. So this type of function is carried out by the molybdenum containing enzymes, which is actually present in the nitrogenase enzymes. Now, this is the structure of a special cofactor ligand for molybdenum nitrogenase. And you can see that here we have molybdenum trapped inside the nitrogenase. And these iron sulfur clusters, they are basically involved for the electron transfer reaction. And that is how the remaining part is the histidine residue. So that is how the nitrogenase, it transfers the electron during different electron transfer reactions and perform the function of different nitrogen interconvergence. So this is known as the FeMO cofactor of the nitrogenase. So this is in this diagram, you can see this is the molybdenum atom and this is the iron sulfur cluster. And this is the cysteine residue, this is histidine residue. And that is how the cofactor, FeMO cofactor of the nitrogenase is formed. Then we have cobalt in some vitamins and they have unique biological roles in the cobalamins, that is the B12 coenzymes. They play very important role in the isomerization reaction. And naturally, they are naturally occurring organometallic compound. Generally, their deficiency causes so many symptoms like the muscle cramping, delay in the nerve conduction. So the cobalt is actually very, it is required in the trace quantities, but it is an essential trace element. Then copper, so it often participates together with iron in the proteins or it has equivalent redox role in some biological reaction. So it is involved in the reversible O2 binding, like in case of hemocyanin, we have seen the role of copper for the oxygen transport reaction, then oxygen activation, electron transfer, and O2 minus dismutation, that is SOD type of mechanism. So the copper, which when it is bind with the protein molecule, is involved in these type of biological reactions. And zinc, so zinc is what it is a relatively abundant metal, and its major concentration is found in the metallothionein, which also serve as the reservoir for other metal like cadmium, copper, mercury. So many well-characterized zinc proteins, they include the redox protein, hydrolases, and nucleic acid binding proteins. Examples are like aminopeptidase, which are extracted from the Aeromonas proteolytica. These contain the zinc ions as at the center of the protein molecule. And iron. Iron is very, very important biologically and most abundant metal in the biology, used by all the plants and animals, including bacteria. And some roles duplicated by other metals, while the others are unique to iron. So like the oxygen transport, it is at the same time iron and copper, they are both are capable of that. However, the organisms which are using these ions, they are different. The different organisms are using the copper as the transport carrier, transport ion, and vertebrates are using iron as the transport method. Then iron use has survived the evolution of the O2 atmosphere on the earth. So this is the peculiar characteristic of iron, and due to the its function involved in the oxygen transport, you can correlate it with the evolution of oxygen atmosphere on the earth. This is the structure of hemoglobin and myoglobin, and this is the cytochrome C. So on one hand, you can see how the iron second is involved in the oxygen transport in the hemoglobin and myoglobin. It is also involved in the electron transfer reactions, which are taking place in different cells. So this is the cytochrome C structure containing iron at the center of porphyrin ring. Then some general transport and storage problems which are associated, they can be discussed, like the charged ions, they must pass through a hydrophobic membrane. Now we know that if you look at this problem from the chemistry point of view, these charged ions, whenever the metal ions are there, they are generally insoluble in any organic solvent. They have that hydrophilicity in their nature, and generally they do not dissolve in the hydrophobic, or you see the organic type of solvents. So how they will pass through a hydrophobic membrane? We know that the cell membrane is what? It is composed of different macromolecules, different macromolecule consisting carbon, hydrogen and oxygen. So when the metal ion has to cross this cell membrane, how it will do that? Because it is hydrophilic by nature, and the membrane is hydrophobic. So like the neutral gases, oxygen and carbon dioxide, and low charge density ions, like anions, they can move directly through the membrane. That is possible for them, that they can pass through the hydrophobic membrane. But the high charge density ions, they require help. So high charge density means what? Smaller size and greater charge. That makes a ion makes an ion high with a high charge density. So example is like sodium ion, potassium ion. They require help. They cannot move by themselves through the hydrophobic membrane. So once they are inside the cell, the metal ions, they must be transported to the location of their use, and then they are released or stored for later. So release from the ligand is often non-trivial, and storage also requires the additional molecules to bind these metal ions. So we have ionophores in the cell membrane, and what these ionophores do, they are the special carrier molecules, and they do what? They wrap it around the metal ion so that they can pass through the membrane by diffusion. So their simple function is, if suppose there has to be some selective uptake of a particular metal ion, then these ionophores which are embedded in the cell membrane, they on the outside of the cell environment, they take up selectively that metal ion by wrapping around it, and then they turn their protein gate inside the cell membrane and open the metal ion inside the cell. So that is how the ionophores, they involved in the transport of these ions in the membrane. Now we have ion channels, and ion channels are the large membrane spanning molecule that form a hydrophilic path for the diffusion. So they actually provide a tunnel for the metal ion to pass through them, and that is of hydrophilic nature, so that they can simply diffuse inside the cell. Then we also have ion pumps, and they actually require energy to work. That is in the form of ATP hydrolysis, they require energy. By using that energy, they transport the metal ions against the concentration gradient in one direction through a membrane. So the ion pumps, they actually perform their function only in the one direction, right? It is not in the both direction. Like if you talk about the sodium pump, so it selectively throws out the sodium from throws the sodium out of the cell. So that is the function of ion pump, and because they work against the concentration gradient, they always require energy input for their function to perform. Then the passive transport we also have. And we have active transport. So these are the two kind of membrane transport. In the passive transport, what happens? The ions, they are coming inside the cell or going outside the cell passively. So they are not utilizing any form of energy. And how it happens? It happens because the movement of the ion is there in the direction of the concentration gradient. So whenever the ions, they have to move along the concentration gradient, then they do not require energy, and simply the simple force is the concentration gradient. They simply diffuse inside or outside the cell. So these type, this type of transport is known as the passive transport. And ionophores and ion channels, they are what? They are the means of the passive transport through the cell membrane. The ionophores, they are doing it by, like I told you, they wrap up the metal ion and then release it inside or outside the cell membrane. And we have ion channels which are providing the hydrophilic pathway for the diffusion of metal ions. So they are actually involved in the passive type of transport, which is actually in the direction of concentration gradient. But what about if the cell has to release selective ions outside the cell, or it has to perform a selective uptake of some ion? So that involves the utilization of energy, because in that case, the cell membrane has to work against the concentration gradient. So how cell will obtain the energy? So we know that the universal source of energy in the cell is ATP. So from the ATP hydrolysis, this active transport is performed. And examples are like ion pumps. Ion pumps, they selectively, they involved in the selective uptake of an anion or selective release of the ion. So they are involved in the one direction only, and they perform their function against the concentration gradient, utilizing the energy obtained from the ATP hydrolysis. Now, choice of the transport mechanism, which transport mechanism will be followed, whether it will be a passive transport mechanism or it will be some active transport mechanism, that choice will depend on the charge of the ion. Like I told you, high charge density cations, they require pumps. When you have a low charge density anions or some small molecules, then they do not require any ion pump for them. But if the charge is high and the size is small, in that case the charge density will be high, and then those cations, they require help. For example, the sodium and potassium ions. Then it is also depending upon the ligand preferences. By merely deciding if the ligands are preferring a particular ion, then definitely the transport can be in the passive mode. But if the ligand preference is not there in the support of the metal ion, then how it will be transported? Then in that case, you require active transport mechanism. So now I have quiz for you from today's lecture. The first question is, can you describe the effect of pi bonding on delta naught? So delta O is the crystal field stabilization energy for the metal ligand bonding, and we have discussed this in the in some of the lectures, that how the metallobiomolecules, they are behaving as a metal ligand bond. They can have a coordination bond, or simply they have van der Waal forces or hydrogen bonding. But how the pi bonding is causing the decrease or increase of the crystal field stabilization energy in the octahedral field? Now, the second question for you is, you have to describe the function of manganese in the photosynthesis. So we have seen that these metal ions, they are involved in so many biological reactions. And photosynthesis is one of the very important biological reactions. So we have seen the structure of chlorophyll A in some of the previous slides. And in that case, you saw that how the magnesium ion was there inside the porphyrin ring. So now you have to find out, what is the function of manganese in the photosynthesis? Then the next question for you is, the what are cytochromes? So cytochromes are what we have just seen, that cytochromes, they have iron and sulfur clusters, and they are performing the function of electron transfer. But in which type of biological reactions they are involved, where they are performing this function of electron transfer? So you need to understand what is the structure of different cytochromes. We have different type of cytochromes, like cytochrome A, cytochrome C, and they are involved during the different electron transfer reaction in the general metabolism of the cell. So you have to find out what are the cytochromes, their structure, and in what type of metabolic functions they are involved. Then next question for you is, do you know any redox active cluster compound? So what do we mean by redox active? That means the cluster compound which can be oxidized and reduced both. So that will be what? It will be the redox active cluster compound. So we have seen that such type of clusters, the redox clusters, they play very important role in the biological system during the electron transfer reactions. So you have to find out any redox active cluster compound, and you need to draw the structure of that compound to understand how they play their role, how they change their oxidation state, how they change their coordination number, and they quickly transfer the electrons from one side to other. So when they receive the electron, they become oxidized. When they release the electron to the next compound in the cycle, they are getting oxidized, and when they receive, they are getting reduced. So they at the same time, they are getting oxidized and reduced. So, what are these redox active cluster compound that you have to find out? Then the last question, it is about the biological nitrogen fixation, and we know that process of biological nitrogen fixation, it plays a very important role in the nitrogen cycle in environment. So, in the nitrogen cycle, this nitrogen fixation is performed by the in the root nodules of the leguminous plant by some symbiotic bacteria. So you have to find out the name of the symbiotic bacteria which is involved in the reaction. Now, nitrogen fixation is what? It is conversion of elemental nitrogen to the nitrate ion. So when you say that it is the fixation of the nitrogen, so basically it is about the conversion of the elemental nitrogen to nitrate ion. Because only the nitrate ion can be taken up by the plants. Otherwise, elemental nitrogen, it is of no use to us. It is of no use to plants. Plants cannot absorb the nitrogen from atmosphere. So how this nitrogen absorption takes place? So it is only in the form of nitrate ion that the plant absorbs the nitrogen, and then it is transferred throughout the food chain to successive trophic levels. To primary consumer, then secondary consumer, then tertiary, and finally to the human beings as well. We are getting our nitrogen requirement from the plants, from the leguminous plant, and sometimes from the animals as well. So that biological nitrogen fixation, it is a very important reaction in the biology, in the environment, because this is the only case when the elemental nitrogen is converted into nitrate by some biological entity. Otherwise, it is very, very uncommon. It is completely, totally absent for any other type of cell. So, this actually incorporates a very important enzyme which has a molybdenum at its center. So, you have to describe the biological nitrogen fixation, why it is so important. You have to describe that, and also you have to include the structure of that enzyme which plays a very important role in nitrogen fixation. Now, apart from that, you have to draw the structure of that enzyme. Showing that how molybdenum is present at the center and how it is playing its role. So if you remember, we have just seen a molybdenum iron cofactor for that enzyme. So that you have to find out, and you have to draw the structure, and also please explain the process of biological nitrogen fixation. So these are some important questions for you from today's lecture. Now, these are the references for today's lecture, and today we discussed about the role of metal ions in the biological system, how different type of metals, they are playing different role in the biological systems, how they are involved in different functions. So today we discussed that. Now, after this lecture, we will meet in the coming lecture, that is the part 4, the fourth lecture on bio-inorganic chemistry, and that is all from my side for today. Thank you so much.